Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our third and final day here at the 50th CIS Men's Volleyball National Championship. We are mere minutes away in this opening serve of the bronze medal match between the number 5 Saskatchewan Huskies and number 6 Alberta Golden Bears. I'm Jared Brown, and I'm joined with Everett DeLorme and Dan Gilbert. And it's been quite a wild ride here, gentlemen. Two fantastic days of volleyball, and we expect this third and final day to be the best of them all. And Dan, what can we look forward to see here on the Saskatchewan team?
Well, I think from Saskatchewan, you're going to see a little bit of energy, and they're going to want to make yesterday right. I think they really wanted to make it through to the finals, but this is their chance to go away with a bronze medal here at the CIS Nationals. So I think you're going to see a little bit more involvement from their middles. Yesterday, they were very effective in the middle, and I think they can force the middle a little bit more today.
And Everett, Alberta obviously came here with very high hopes, mm-hmm. two-time defending CIS champions, now playing for bronze, a position they haven't been in for a few years. What do you think we're going to see on their side of the court today?
Well, I mean, they were in this exact situation last weekend in the Canada West playoffs, but even then, that was more of a must-win to get here. So, you know, they've been here before. Yesterday was an unfortunate loss to end that chance at a three-peat, but this is a veteran team. There's an endless amount of skill and talent on the team, so I'm sure they'll be able to bounce back for a solid match today.
Yeah, it's always tough to recover, especially with a short turnaround time. I mean, both these teams yesterday played in that evening match. By the time they probably got to bed, had something to eat, did the game plan pretty late for today, and now here we are back at 3 o'clock, and they're playing again, and, you know, it's playing 3 days in a row, which is something that these teams don't do too often throughout the year as well. But two very veteran teams, lots of experience on both sides of the net, and my experience in these games is, you know, interestingly enough, my last Nationals as a coach with U of M was in this very gym, and we were in the same situation. We played against Dalhousie for the bronze medal. We were victorious, and I think the tendency is when the match starts, it's, you know, you're not really too excited, you're still kind of disappointed, but especially when you're playing a team that you have a little bit of a rivalry against, two conference teams here from the Canada West. Once you get going, the competitiveness takes over, and it typically ends up being a really good match.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's still a medal on the line. There's still pride on the line. You still don't like to lose. So while it is not going for the color you want, you're still out there. You're still on the court. You still got a chance to get better and show what you got. And none of these guys are going to shy away from that situation today.
An interesting thing for Alberta, starting the year off with 23 straight wins, the last way you want to end the season is with two straight losses. So I'm sure both teams here, I mean, it's not the color you want to win, but it's certainly better than not winning anything at all. And especially with the 50 of your players here, you want to go out, you know, in style, finish your career off on a high note. We've got Graham versus Saskatchewan, and then on the Alberta side, Barnes and Gorenson. Of course, Taylor Arnett injured in that semifinal yesterday, still not able to play today. Speaking with Coach Zavik, said he will be fine long term, but they're not going to dress him today. He's just in plain clothes on the bench. So it will be Chambers who gets to start again here. First serve of the match will go to Alberta, and it will be Brett Walsh, the CIS Player of the Year, who puts it into play. That's passed up there by Noah Koski, somewhat of a folk hero in this tournament after that performance on Thursday. With that attack from Graham, goes into the net, and the first point of the bronze medal game goes to the Golden Bears.
Yeah, a weird set choice from CJ Gavlis. He wasn't in the right position there to set the middle. He forced a little, just undersets Graham for the first Bears point.
Brett Walsh, been served. Again, taken by Noah Koski off the net. Gavlis goes back to his 50 or outside. That's passed up there by McMullen. And Barnes, first swing, covered there nicely by Chambers. Walsh back to Nikifor as it's tight. He's got to go try to keep it alive. Great save there by Gavlis as the play continues. Noah Koski with the tip. May comes across. Walsh bump set. Barnes going to take a high ball swing here, and that's kept alive there by Hagenbach. Great dig. Great defense early on. Nelson, soft block back to the Husky side. Gavlis outside to Noah Koski, and that one goes into the net. 2-0 U of A.
You know, you just mentioned how it might take a few points to get into the game, but here we are, point number two, a great rally and great exchange already here early on.
I was discussing the 50-year players. Of course, we can't forget Jordan Noah Koski from Rama, Saskatchewan. Interestingly enough, lived for a year in Manitoba in high school to move back to Saskatchewan. Off the top of the block, McMullen, nice diving save. May bumps it nice and high to Barnes, and Barnes goes up way high to get it. And he finds the corner. That one just barely got around the aerial there. I think Saskatchewan just caught off guard with such an athletic play there from Barnes.
Yeah, that was real impressive. I thought he had maybe caught a hand or something, but nope, put that in the back corner. And great cross-court shot by Barnes.
You see Barnes' knee is heavily taped up there. I think he's battling through some things as the got in the late part of the year. Him as a fifth-year player, and that's pretty typical. The aches and pains really start to pile up as you go through your career. May, nice dig on the Nowakowski attack, and that falls in. We'll give the kill to the libero, Reed May.
One thing we want to look at here today is just how long it takes Saskatchewan to get into things. We talked about taking a little bit of time to adjust and to come out strong in a bronze medal game. Let's not forget that they played right up until almost 11 o'clock last night. It was a pretty late match. By the time they were out of here and would have got fueled up and settled down, it's a pretty short turnaround, probably the shortest turnaround of the year for them in terms of coming back to the court to play.
Absolutely. And I should say quickly, just want to get this out of the way. Speaking with some of the coaches from Saskatchewan yesterday, I came under fire a little bit, Everett. I guess apparently in our game against UNB, some of the Saskatchewan fans thought that I was an Eastern Canadian talking about the prairie life. You know, I'm from Winnipeg. I know what it's all about. And I was lumping us all in together, saying those harsh winters, mosquitoes in the summer. I know what it's all about, and that's part of, it's a good thing. It was a compliment. It wasn't intended to be an insult. So my apologies, I guess, to anybody out there who took it the wrong way.
And I support you on that one. I'm born in Winnipeg. My dad's from Saskatchewan, so I got plenty of family in Chisdale and Assiniboia and plenty of other places.
Back to the action. Nowakowski stuff block there by Nikifor and Chambers. And early on, no signs from this Alberta team showing they don't want to be in this game. They're looking great. We have a replay queued up here. We see a nice block there by Nikifor. He's been great all weekend.
So far defensively, Alberta's been real impressive, including that block. We've seen three other digs, four big defensive plays and 5 points. They're dialed in here today.
Nelson out of the back row, and again, he meets the wall of the Golden Bears. Ryley Barnes with the stuff block. 6-0 U of A, and I think we're going to see a substitution here coming in already for U of S. Another replay there on that block. Great job by the Golden Bears. Looks like the substitution was turned away. Didn't quite get the paddle in time. Walsh continues to serve. Nice pass there from Fraser. Gavis looks for the dump, trying to do it himself, but it's kept alive by the U of A block. Back to Nikifor with a tip. That soft block kept alive there by McMullen. Now it's going to be a joust at the net. Barnes goes up way high to get it, and Nowakowski can't come up with the dig. An interesting thing would be, if you're U of A, in your mind, if you're the team and the staff, you'd probably say, guys, we've been, in our opinion, the best team all year, or at least one of the top two in Canada all season long. If we end this year without a medal, it would be a real tragedy. Let's put something on the line here. And so far, we're looking pretty impressive, up 7-0. Coach Gavis doing anything he can here, trying to slow the momentum. He's actually made a substitution here now. Ian Ferrer, the second-year middle from Drinkwater, Saskatchewan, has checked in. Graham takes a seat on the bench. Walsh continuing to serve. That pass from Fraser off the net. Gavis, high ball to Nowakowski. Three-man block. McMullen, nice dig in six. Walsh bumps it to keep it alive. Free ball coming here to the Huskies. Let's see if they can finally get a side out here and try and get some momentum on their side. Nelson, back row. Block was late, but he hits it wide. 8-0, U of A.
And I guess one thing to question here is a lot of balls so far going to Nowakowski, and he hasn't been able to find the court yet. Yesterday, he didn't play as well as on the first day. 30 kills on that first day. Will he have a performance like that again?
Yeah, you wonder if he just... They had to get everything they could from him to get through that match. And, it's tough to rebound after such a huge workload. Now here, Barnes left side, soft block. McMullen diving save. Walsh tried for the pancake, doesn't get enough. And the Huskies get a much-needed side out. They trail 8-1.
Yeah, finally the Huskies get on the board. But once again, we see that defensive intensity. I think McMullen's made 3 or 4 digs already early on in this set. So they're dialed in here. They're here to play, and they want to leave with that medal.
Going to be an uphill battle now in this set for Saskatchewan as they trail 8-1 against one of the top teams in the country. Barnes, nice skill cross court. 9-1 lead, and it will be Ryley Barnes, the fifth year outside, going back to serve as we see this ball queued up there nicely. The Barnes, one-on-one, puts it home. I was impressed with the ability by Barnes yesterday. Started off, putting the ball away, but also had lots of errors to go with it. Really cleaned up. He went through those late stages of that match and was one of Alberta's best players. They lost ultimately in 5 sets to Tierney Western. Nikifor really solid yesterday and continuing again yet today. Nice kill down the line. If we've seen this one here, Locke was late. Augenbach had really no chance to come up with that one. We're going to have another timeout, 10-1 U of A.
Right now, the defense for Alberta is just on point. Everything seems to be in their comfortable zone. Every ball is up. Their transition is working perfectly. U of A has come here to do business and get that medal. And so far, Saskatchewan, they're looking tired. They can't really muster anything. Gavlis, his location is a bit off, and his swingers can't take a good crack at it. So they just need to maybe get a big block, a big dig, some big play to get the energy up and get things going on their side.
They've got to start to be more aggressive on offense too, and start to hit some good angles. You know, hard aggressive cross shots or high hands, maybe try and fuel the line. But they've had 14 swings and they have zero kills. Yes, this is a big Alberta blocking team. They're scrappy on defense and control the system on defense. It's going to be tough to score, but you gotta step up on the Saskatchewan side and you've got to go for it.
Interesting thing to consider here, guys, is I remember speaking with Alex Strachan, libero from U of M, just about how things went wrong for them last weekend. And, you know, he said in that bronze medal match to ultimately qualify for this tournament against Alberta, he didn't feel that any team in the country would have been able to slow Alberta down in that match. And you wonder if that's a bit of a similar situation here for Saskatchewan, right? They're just kind of, unfortunately, on the wrong side of the net against a team who, you know, doesn't want to end their season without a medal after how been this good all year. And it, really, the Bears haven't given the Huskies much of a chance here so far, but you see an early mistake there now as we get a side out after Alberta was on the net. And it will be Noah Costin, who goes back to serve. One of the best individual performances of this tournament on that Thursday against UNB. 31 points as McMullen off the top of the block. 9-point lead restored, 11-2. I'm a little bit worried, guys, because I'm already having a bit of a hard time hearing you. And it's only going to be even crazier in here for the next match. It's getting pretty loud already. Gavlis, nice diving save. Free ball coming here to U of A. Chambers there to pass it up. They go, not quite sure what that was supposed to be there. I think he was trying to go to the pipe and got a little bit too much of it. Ball there off the top of the head of Mr. Ford. And that was kind of an interesting run. Was he trying to go to the left? Was he trying to go to the right? Was he trying to go to the pipe?
I think he was trying to go to the left. It just didn't come out as far as he wanted.
Yeah, he came out and he was kind of laughing to himself as he's getting back into defense. And after chasing that ball, an odd miss set there from Brett Walsh.
Barnes, perfect pass. Walsh over top of the middle to McMullen. And that run is so dangerous. He had that overload there in the middle coming across. The blockers really get stuck. And McMullen with an easy side out. McMullen looking a little bit more relaxed today, I think, than yesterday. Coming out of the gates with a couple early kills here. And they try to find Epp off the net. Really tough set there. Not much F to do on that one. 10-point lead now, 13-3 U of A. Nikifor continues to serve here for the Golden Bears. That serve taken there by Hagenbach. Outside to Fraser, look for the roll shot. Walsh soft blocks it back to the Husky side. Nelson on the right, McMullen, one-on-one, Steph Brock. 14-3 U of A. We have a substitution checking in here. As you see the replay of that block there, McMullen up nice and high. Austin Alexson will check in from Prince Albert, Saskatchewan. Giving Gavlis a chance to talk to his son here about what he sees on the court. Nikifor serve taken there by Nowakowski. Alexson goes middle to Epp. A great hit, but just wide. Things are not going to UFS's way so far.
A very very tough attack to make. Set her backed up close to the pin, setting a ball 50-5. There's really not a lot of court to hit at there.
12-point advantage for U of A. This might be the biggest lead we've seen for any team in the tournament so far. And it hasn't, Saskatchewan, they're doing, I think, a couple mistakes, but U of A is just really on fire.
Absolutely. Saskatchewan, they don't look too down right now.
Nope.
They don't look too bad. They're playing, they're trying different things, and they're switching it up, but U of A just on point and really just trying to redeem themselves after that match last night.
A point like that will help, though, with service ace for Nelson. And Nelson really picked up his play yesterday. He had a really strong match against McMaster, especially early on. I mean, Mac really kind of poured it on in the third set, but the first two, Nelson was right there, a big factor. In those two close sets that maybe could have gone the Huskies' way, they might be left wondering what could have been if they could have won one of those first two and put the pressure onto McMaster. And with that kill there, we have a timeout, as we're going to see here, the kill from Goranson in the middle. And Goranson will, after winning the last two seasons, will try to finish his career off with a bronze medal today if they can be victorious.
Be interesting to see.
I'll take a quick look here. Sorry, Everett, we're just going to take a quick look about some of the great plays early on here from Alberta in this set. You know, really doing a fantastic job at the net. They went on that stretch yesterday. They didn't have a scuff block for two sets yesterday against Trinity Western. I believe now they're probably already at about four or five team blocks in these first 16 points. And they've really been tough, big presence at the net.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned John Gordon before. It'd be interesting to see what he does after this match, after this year. Does he go to Gatineau at the FTC with the national team? Does he look for a contract? I definitely think he's got a future in volleyball. He's a dynamic player. He's explosive at the net. He's offensive. He close blocks well. I'd love to see him play at the next level.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see. I mean, he's traditionally a bit undersized, I would say, height-wise for a middle, but he has good leaping ability, really strong player, very quick along the net. I mean, he'd be would have a couple inches on Rudy Verhoef, I would think, who's with the national team. So there is a path for players of that size as long as they're skilled. And one thing we don't ever want to do is shut the door on players in our country just because of their size. Let the guys go out and play and let that be the difference maker.
Especially since he's been in that national team program before. He spent a couple summers within the junior national team, and he's been around that program. He's a guy that, you know, Glenn Hogan, Vince Abichette have already identified as being one of those elite middles in the country. So definitely see no harm in him going to spend a year at Gatineau, get a little stronger, get a little better, and maybe go find a contract somewhere like Sweden or Germany or France, where a lot of Canadians are playing these days.
Alexson off the net, goes backward to Nelson. McMullen, nice job keeping that alive. Bump set outside to Barnes, and Barnes looks for the hands, doesn't find them. Point U of S.
McMullen's defensive intensity today. I think that's six or seven digs for him. We saw it in the replays just during that timeout, and another dig in the deep one corner there.
Still a 9-point lead though. The Huskies have a lot of work left ahead of them here in this set, but they're playing better as of late, getting a few more positive touches. Alexson goes back to Fraser, and he is back row violation, was over that attack line. Side out now for U of A, 17-7. Now it will be Gornson with the serve. Jump float taken there by Hagenbach. Noah Koski left side, and Nikifor off the shoulder. You see Walsh taking a tumble there. I think Chambers came across and kind of took him out on his own side of the net.
We're finally starting to see Saskatchewan manufacture their own points. We're seeing Novoskoski swing high off hands, a few points there, and finally on the board, but like you said earlier, a long way to go.
Ep serve, passed up there by May. Walsh goes up to get it, one-on-one for Barnes, and that's a matchup Barnes is gonna win a high percentage of the time.
Yeah, you leave that seam open for Barnes, you leave that middle of the court, he's going to put it down without any question.
18-8 Golden Bears, the CIS player, Canada West player, both taking home the awards this year for Brett Walsh. And that swing from Nowakowski, he seems to have found himself a little bit of a rhythm here, back-to-back kills for the fifth year outside. 18-9, DJ Jukebox. Back for his third day in a row. Maybe he'll be doing the DJ at the celebration tonight somewhere too, wouldn't be surprised. It's Nikifor, great swing down the line.
You know what, depending which team wins tonight, I'd bet that he would be.
Yeah, I mean, if it were to be Mac who wins this gold medal game, they might just let everybody party right down here on the floor and have DJ Jukebox turn the lights down a little bit. And it could be quite the party here at Bird's Gym.
That would be quite the time as we see Ryley Barnes tee it up from the baseline and rip one. Hagenbach, a rare ace on him there.
Yeah, Hagenbach's been solid. Mm-hmm. Maybe not quite as overly flashy and, you know, kind of just very steady, you know, compared to some of the other liberos here. Really has done a good job for the Huskies all tournament long. Nelson's pass off the net. Alexson goes back to him off the top of the block. Tipped alive here. May is going to bump set outside to Nikifor. And a nice block there from the Huskies. That's Nelson and Ferrer teaming up.
So the Huskies chipping away here one at a time, hopefully gaining some momentum.
Yeah, at the very least, you know, feeling a little bit better about this matchup heading into the next set. It's going to be still pretty tough to come back and win the first one, but it is a long game. best of five. You got to take your points while you can. And they certainly found much more rhythm here. Nice kill there from Nelson.
Yeah, they're starting to scrap a little more. And we said it before when they were struggling. They didn't look down. They didn't look defeated. They didn't look broken. You know, just things weren't working out. They found their groove. They found that momentum. And I'm sure we're in for a great rest of the match here.
Yeah, and a good job by Coach Gavlis to make a couple substitutions, call a couple timeouts, just change the feel of the court. I wouldn't be surprised if the players he took off end up back on the court in the second set. But giving them a chance to clear their minds a little bit. And then, you know, and Ferrer, too, he hasn't seen any court action so far this tournament. Get him out there and see what he can do.
And I think the Saskatchewan Huskies right now have just taken a sigh of relief. They've just kind of breathed out, and they're playing much stronger here, taking some swings at much better angles.
Thought we could have got a four hits call there as Ferrer actually went up to hit that over bump, and it looked to me like it caught his fingertips. And then they dug it up. Hugenbach came in and set it, but it was a point for U of A regardless as they got the block.
Aaron Chambers is switching sides of the court. He's going to serve on as he sees his assignment.
Score 21-12. Also a great album by Rush. Now 22-12. I'm not aware of any music albums named 22-12. Wanted to get that in there quickly before that point ended. Was an over the net violation there on Alexson. Back row setter. And we have 22-12. Chambers. Interesting, you know, again, talked to Coach Davidoff before the match and just about Arnett and how he was doing. And, you know, he thought Chambers served really well for U of A yesterday coming off the bench. And, you know, we all kind of agreed he had himself a good match. That wasn't really the issue for them. It's not like they lost because of that injury. But good to see for them, as you'd think he'll probably start and step into the starting lineup next year with Goranson graduating. And they're going to have a hole to fill there, too, with Barnes really having a good first set here. He's in his last match ever as a Golden Bear. And somebody from this roster will have to step into that position next season, as we see Hagenbach outside to Fraser and just powers it through the block.
Fraser's quietly having his best game so far of the tournament. Four kills in one set, really turning it up here for the Saskatchewan Huskies.
23-14, Nelson with the jump float, taken there by Barnes. Walsh goes to Goranson, and Goranson has, again, he has a little bit of hang time to him there as well, right? Not only just the jump, but he's up there for a while, and he can delay and cut that ball back into one. It's a tough shot for the defense.
Absolutely.
We now have a set point opportunity. It will be McMullen on the line for the Golden Bears. They look to take a one set to none lead here if they can cap things off right now. But Fraser with the roll shot, dug up there by Nickerfor. Barnes is going to set to Goranson, who is split onto the right. That soft block. He goes in to set Barnes back on the U of A side once again. Walsh just goes up and does it himself. Dumps it down. And with that, the Golden Bears win the first set 25-14. We get a chance to see a replay there from Walsh. Good job. Finish things off in style there. I'd be curious to see now, guys, does Coach Gavlis go back to his starters or keep the lineup that he finished with in that first set?
That will be very interesting, Jared, because in the first 15 attacks for Saskatchewan, they had no kills. In their next 14 attempts, they had 8 kills. Most of that happened after those changes had been made on the court.
Absolutely. Just I would like to keep those guys in. I mean, go with what you're working for. If your regular starters aren't getting the job done, then put in some guys off the bench and maybe they bring some energy.
Okay, guys, we have a chance to see some highlights here from the Golden Bears side. It is Ryley Barnes, some of his best plays of that first set. Very impressive here early on. I mentioned this is his last match in the CIS. And Dan, what can you tell us about Ryley Barnes?
Well, I think Ryley Barnes, obviously, he's in his fifth and final year, 6'6" outside. Final career game for the Alberta Golden Bears. He has 31 kills in this tournament, which gets him in seventh place overall. He's hitting at 27%, 11 digs, and has a total of 34 points, which will put him at eighth place in this tournament out of all players. So Ryley Barnes really been a great contributor for his team, and I thought that even though maybe not leading his team in any individual match in terms of his number of attempts and performance in that regard, really holding his team together as they came through this tournament.
And then Everett, we have Ryan Nikifor as well. And Nikifor, as you see his stats here on the screen, is a pretty impressive player as well.
Yeah, absolutely. 31 kills in the tournament. He was lights out yesterday for the Golden Bears. 7 blocks, 3.88 kills per set. 36.5 points, a 311 hitting percentage, and he's really a guy to watch in the next few years for the, or next year especially for the Alberta Golden Bears as they look to get back into that gold medal match in 2017.
Yeah, we see Nikifor here, and Nikifor, an interesting case. You know, he started with the Golden Bears, but he still was only 17, you know, finished school a year early, so he had the interesting situation of being able to play a year for U of A and then go back and play a club season, you know, 18-year club season, and he got to play on his home court at the Savo Center, and they ultimately made it all the way to the final before they lost that national championship that season. And you know, now here he is in his fourth year of eligibility with U of A.
You know, when we talked about that earlier with Graham about taking a redshirt season, so you know, Nikifor going in, taking a year off, going back to club, getting some more playing time, getting a bit of more maturity, and then coming back to university and playing. And you know, volleyball is a sport that you excel at the older ages. You know, it's tough to get and understand when you're younger, and as you grow into your body and as you become more adept at reading the game, you truly become a better player as you get older. So there's nothing wrong with, you know, taking a few years off to get stronger, to get a little more organized, and to get a little bit smarter before you jump onto a CIS team and make that run for a CIS championship.
Just to add with Ryley Barnes there, I know I mentioned he hasn't led his team yet in attempts in either of the first two matches. He did lead his team in kills yesterday with 24 kills.
Ryley Barnes, I think, is someone who I really want to keep my eye on moving on into the next stages of his volleyball career. You know, we talked earlier about Jorgensen and his role on the junior national team, and you know, Ryley Barnes had an even bigger role in the junior national team as the top scorer, and you know, he's someone that Glenn Hogue and Vincent Chet have also had their eye on, and next year is either pro or FGC for him for sure.
Hagenbach, great job coming out of the back row with that set, but Fraser unable to help him out. And one sub that we see here is we have Dylan Tarbett has come into the game. And Tarbett here, oh, that, I thought that ball was called out, actually, it was in. So good job there from Fraser. The linesman called it out and header free overruled. Chambers kept alive there by Hagenbach. Nikifor goes off the block of Gavlis and out. Yeah, Tarbett has come in here for Nelson.
We saw that move yesterday from Saskatchewan as well.
Go to four-man service here on the serve from Barnes. Nice pass there, just subbed into the game. Fraser with the tip. Walsh got the pancake, but U of A was on the net. So a better start, obviously 8-0 the first set. Tied up at 2 here so far. Good job of the Huskies to rebound. And then really, after that beginning stretch, they were pretty much point for point with Alberta. Walsh outside to McMullen, and that thing goes long, no touch. 3-2, the Huskies' first lead of the game.
Early on here, Fraser doing a great job, 6 points. Now early into the second set, and he's been a little bit quiet. Novakovsky's carried the load, Nelson a little bit more, but today Fraser's stepping up and being big for the Huskies. Another tough serve there by him as well.
Low pass from Barnes, but Walsh does a good job just to get it up in the air, and McMullen uses the block of Gavlis and out of bounds. Nice smart play there by McMullen. 3-3 with Chambers serving. If all these, if everybody in the stands here stays for this next game, there's not going to be a ton of room for the all the McMaster fans, and who knows, maybe most of those Mac fans are already here, but I expect to see a lot more maroon as Nowakowski just with the little roll shot into the center of the court and caught Alberta's defense off guard.
Interestingly enough, I see a few fans wearing maroon shirts but wearing green and yellow wigs. They're, you know, are they batting for either side here? What's going on, guys?
Hey, you can only have one favorite team. Epp spin serve. Nice job there by May. Epp with the dig, but Gavlis is on the net. And I think as a middle, you have so few rare opportunities to get a dig. When you do get a dig and some of your team's on the net, it must just be a killer for you, right? Because you might not officially get that dig stat if the referee blows his whistle early enough there. It's got to be, got to hurt. You're just trying to pad the stats. It's, that ball's passed over the net, and McMullen and Goranson are there to put it down.
That's a good point, Jared. I remember at the after the 2012 CIS Championships, I did a breakdown of some of the numbers, just how many attempts on defense a middle actually made relative to the other attempts blocking, attacking, and being involved in the serve. And it was actually about 3% of their involvement was playing defense.
Yeah, they don't get too many chances. That swing from Tarbert goes into the net. 6-4 Alberta. Gives you a chance to see that one there. The block of U of A has been strong early on here in this match. Make a four serve. Nice diving pass by Hagenbach. Go pipe to Fraser. Soft block. Hagenbach with the cover. Done a good job just to get out of the way. Nowakowski looking for the hands. Doesn't find them. U of S wanting a net call, wanting a touch call, wanting something. They're not going to get it.
I definitely thought I saw a touch there. I didn't hear it or anything, but no call on the touch. Alberta point.
Dan, I made mention to Everett on the first day before you had arrived, as we actually see a service ace there from Alberta. But I made a point that if a player, I have a chance to sort of see this ace here from Nikifor, but if a player ever asks for a touch call and there wasn't one there, or just in general, period, even if there was one there, a team automatically loses the game. That's the new rule in volleyball. You know, sometimes you got to accept that you just hit the ball out of bounds, right? And you see some guys every time they hit it, make a hitting error, begging for that call. And the problem is with that is that sometimes you actually do get a touch, right? And if every time you hit the ball out, you're looking for it, I feel like the referee is less prone to kind of wonder if there actually was one. Nikifor out of the back row.
You guys have been getting ball touches all weekend. I've still yet to have one.
Yeah, because you're in the middle. We're kind of protecting you here. You know, our range, we're kind of shielding you from there. The quick reflexes, cat-like reflexes from the professor, Dan Gilbert. That's what led his team to a slow pitch title back in Manitoba back in the day for the, what was it, the Ligers? Isn't that the team name there, Dan? As that ball goes way up high into the backboard. Is that the team name?
Ligers? That was the team name.
The Ligers. Yeah. Impressive. A little bit of Napoleon Dynamite right there.
Yeah, exactly. They voted for Pedro. 9-6, three-point lead for Alberta. Nowakowski serve. They go back to Goranson. Ooh. And John Goranson, great run. Great find by the center, Brent Walsh. We'll have a chance to see this one queued up here. Quickly back to Goranson, and not much the Huskies can do there.
And the key with that play is that it's very unorthodox in terms of the spacing from the setter. So just a real good feel for the hitter where Goranson was going to be. It wasn't your typical 60 right behind the setter. It wasn't right to the pin. It was halfway in between.
Tarbert off the hands. McMullen with the dig. Walsh puts it up there for Barnes. Great dig. Hagenbach. Tarbert with the save. Free ball coming here to the Golden Bears side. Walsh quickly now outside to Barnes, and Hagenbach can't come up with it. 11-6 Alberta, and that early lead for Saskatchewan has vanished. Now we're going to see a timeout from Coach Gavlis. His team down 5, I think, playing better, but again, Alberta's just cranking up the level of play here. 5-point lead after they won the first set. Doing their best to try to take a two-set to none stranglehold in this CIS bronze medal match.
Now, even though Saskatchewan's looking better, Alberta's just staying the course. It's business like as per usual. They're playing great defense. They're swinging away, and Ryley Barnes has really turned it on right here in his last match. You're trying to see Brett Walls really favoring Barnes and Goranson, really giving them the opportunity to get some good swings and get a great feeling in the pursuit of a medal in their last match in the CIS.
11-6 is the score here. 5-point advantage for Alberta as the teams return to the court. And the middle of Saskatchewan really been a non-factor so far. We've seen them be very effective when used. And I think just part of it is the tough passing from Alberta, the tough serving, Saskatchewan's passing, not able to get the middles too much involved. And Knepp and Graham both have the ability to get some big points here for this Huskies team. That pass off the net, bump set to Tarbert, just going to give a free ball to the Alberta side. Chambers there to keep it alive. Walsh outside to Barnes. Barnes up the top of the block. Nowakowski with the save. Bump set outside to Tarbert, and Tarbert off the aerial. 12-6 Alberta.
Yeah, you mentioned the involvement from the middles. We saw a kill from Graham a little bit earlier. He was quick. He was there on time, but it's too far in between, and there's just no respect from the Alberta middles right now as they press to the outsides.
6-point lead. Another tough serve there, just handcuffing all of the receivers on this Husky side. And again, they go to that 60-type run there to Chambers. Soft block, but kept alive. Another soft block back onto the Alberta side again. And this time, Nikifor down the line. Great dig off the chest by Hagenbach. He's going to give a free ball now to Alberta. Pulls Walsh off the net. Barnes left side, cross court. And the Golden Bears are on fire, 13-6.
Yeah, just a barrage of offense from there. You're seeing it all. You're seeing it from Gorenson in the middle. You're seeing from Nikifor and Walsh on the outside. And really just, they go at it until they finally break through.
13-6 as Nelson has checked in. And the serve here from Alberta is giving all kinds of trouble to the Huskies. Barnes left side, but a nice block there from Graham and Nelson. And Graham's one of those guys that's kind of always got a smile on his face as we're going to see a chance to get one queued up here. And nice job closing that block from Graham, the Dale Iwanosko Memorial Scholarship winner in his seventh season with the team, his final season of eligibility from Saskatoon. Walsh slipped on that one, bump set just to keep it alive to Nikifor. Graham with the dig. Fraser left side. And May and McMullen kind of crash into each other there. And yeah. McMullen's saying that he had that one.
Yeah.
A little too anxious on that one.
May is hanging out in the middle of the court. He's playing that five position. McMullen's in six. And May is maybe a little too overeager to get involved. He hasn't had too many touches on the ball so far. So McMullen definitely there in position and has been playing great defensively so far this match.
Walsh on the run, goes back to Nikifor. Got a piece of the block. Graham keeps it alive. Fraser left side. Looks for the hands and does not get them.
It was a close shot. It's always tough. Unfortunately, no challenge system yet in the CIS. Definitely like to see it come one day, though.
Yeah, we'll see. I would think we're probably a couple years at least away from that, but it would be nice if they could incorporate that into the CIS championships. Serve from Walsh into the net. One of the rare serving mistakes he's made this whole tournament. It's been very effective from the line. 14-9 as Nelson goes back to serve. Owen Barnes' ball kind of bottomed out on him a little bit there. Fell in front, and a service ace for Nelson. Huskies have closed this to a 4-point game. 14-10 is the score in the second. If you are just joining us, it was Alberta victorious in the first, and Laval, who took fifth place earlier as Epp tries to put his mark on this match. It's interesting, guys, we see a chance here on the replay as Epp goes up and shuts the door, but this Huskies team, they're definitely not one to roll over. You know, against Mac yesterday, we saw that, and it's continued to battle all the way through, and they're not going to make it easy on Alberta, that's for sure, as they've closed it now, just a 2-point ball game, 14-12.
Absolutely, and time again, I thought this Huskies team was ready to go to bed, ready to sleep. We saw it on the first day against UNB, where they fought back and went an ugly five-setter. We saw it yesterday against McMaster, where they didn't really, give up or give it away to McMaster until the end of the third, and we're seeing again here against the Golden Bears.
Yeah, Nelson's come off the bench and been a big factor here. Very tough serving as Gavis looks to dump that one. The pass just a little bit too tight, but Barnes was all over it.
Once again, as you praised, Nelson passes that ball a little tight, and Alberta's back on the board. We saw Epp get a block there, and that's the first time he's on the board today, and he's going to want to heat up.
Yeah, he's very dangerous there if they can get him going. Barnes' serve unleashes. Nice pass, Nowakowski, and they go to Epp. The set's a little bit too tight. Good job just to save it. Chambers tries to dump it over, and Epp is there. Good job there by Epp.
As you mentioned, getting Epp involved is a very good thing for Saskatchewan. 7 kills, 2 errors in yesterday's match, and he's got his first 2 points today, but they've opened on the block.
Yep, you're seeing Gavlis really trying to get him involved there. It was an ugly set. He still gets it over and is rewarded with the block afterwards.
Fraser's jump float taken by Barnes. Walsh back to Nikifor. Off the block of the Huskies and long side out Alberta. 16-13, Alberta leading at the second technical timeout. So we have a three-point lead here. And we have the Investors Group t-shirt toss happening here as the fans get up on their feet looking for a free shirt. I think all the game day staff has done a tremendous job all tournament long. And just want to make special thanks to our webcast partner, McMaster University Center for Continuing Education. Been with it since the beginning and all the way through this entire tournament. We thank you very much for your contributions in making this event possible. And you know, guys, there's a lot of people, and I think sometimes we forget that. You know, when we come as coaches and, you know, as players, and you come to these events, even just as a fan, sometimes forget how many people are involved in tournaments like this. And you look around and you see all the green shirts, all the volunteers and people we've seen here for 3 days long. You know, it really is remarkable, and it takes an entire community of people to make events like this possible. It's not just the university staff, and we have, I think, a lot of club volleyball players here helping volunteer and, you know, different people from around the community, and it's a testament to volleyball in this Hamilton area that we have an event like this.
And I mean, the volleyball in this Hamilton area is fantastic. The women's team here at McMaster making the OUA Final Four and, you know, pushing, narrowly missing out on that bronze medal, losing in a five-set match to Western. You know, you look at the CCAA side of things, the Mohawk Mountaineers on the other side of the country right now competing in the CCAA Nationals. You know, the Smash Volleyball Club donating their players their time this weekend as volunteers. You know, you got the OVA Coaches Symposium going on this weekend as well, and the OVA High Performance Team is getting together and have their meetings to set up for the year. So it's a really great celebration of volleyball here this weekend in Hamilton, sorry.
Yes, it's just an awesome opportunity for all the young volleyball players and coaches for that matter too, just to see volleyball at the highest level in the country. As Sorensen gets a block there on Noah Koski, 17-13.
No, absolutely. It's a great chance. I was telling all my club players, yeah, you guys need to get tickets. You need to, you know, be here. Unfortunately, with March break starting up, a lot of them are going down south. But actually, my little brother took the train in from Ottawa this morning. He's sitting in the stands, 14 years old, getting a chance to see this. It's a great opportunity.
As we see a service ace there by Chambers. We have a timeout from Coach Dallas. And we should make mention that, obviously, the CIS Women's Volleyball Nationals are going on right now as well. And they're sort of a day behind our schedule. Mm-hmm. Their semifinals are today, and then the finals are tomorrow. Well, that's in Brandon, Manitoba, just 2 hours away from Winnipeg. And I know basically every volleyball person in that Westman area in Manitoba, Brandon, Verdun, you know, Suris, all in that area, they were at those matches last night, and apparently it was just an electric atmosphere in the Brandon match, the last game of the day against the number one seed, Trinity Western University Spartans. But it was Trinity Western who was victorious 3-1. And you know, that's a very interesting situation to keep an eye on, is that school has the potential to win both men's and women's, as the women are in their semifinals today, and of course the men in the next match after this one against McMaster. And that would be something that would be pretty remarkable if that could happen.
Absolutely. BC looking real strong right now. You've got three teams on the women's side in the semifinal. The one semifinal, UBC versus Trinity Western. The other one, UBCO versus the University of Toronto Varsity Blues. So just like on the men's, three teams from the Canada West, one team Ontario in that top four.
Yeah, and I believe U of T had a very close match in their opening round. We're victorious, and yeah, interesting point. Three Canada West and one OUA on both men's and women's. But I think for that Brandon team, they won undefeated in the second half, actually, of conference play, which is pretty remarkable. You can see a great job here defensively for the Huskies. Middle to Gorenson, and Nelson can't come up with the dig, but just to finish the quick thought on the women's is, you know, if you are able tomorrow, as their finals go tomorrow, make sure you tune in again to the webcast and check things out in Brandon. And this is a great time of year for volleyball in the country.
I wish I could be, and I'm jumping on a plane at 7 a.m. to go skiing in Kelowna, actually. Yeah, home of the UBCO Heat.
I'm going right home and going to a tournament to coach, so it'll be a long day tomorrow as Noah Koski goes off the block and long. 15-9, the Huskies trail. Down by four as Gavis goes back to serve. The Golden Bears look to try to take a 2-set-to-none lead if they can wrap this thing up here. The Huskies have showed some spirit late. Nice dig. Let's see if Noah Koski can chase it down.
After Carter Bergen came flying into our stand yesterday, I ducked as soon as I saw Noah Koski. He's much bigger than Bergen, so I was ready to jump out of the way.
Yeah, I wasn't hanging in there for that one.
Nope.
Bergen came flying by us. Like you said, he's a little easier. Noah Koski, I think, almost took out that whole table there. behind us. Brenda Willis and Michael Amoroso sitting there and a couple other delegates. Almost got a lap full from Noah Kosky.
It's a pretty big lap dog right there.
Yeah, absolutely. And that one goes long.
Ooh. You could, you know.
Gavis calling it in. Gavis on the bench.
Yeah, I thought that was in. You could hear the crowd behind us give kind of an ooh as the linesperson put their flag up. And points Saskatchewan.
Brock Davidek got a laugh from that. He looked over and saw Gavis telling the linesman it should have been in. And now he sees Saskatchewan on the net. You know, in this game, there's so many close calls, right? They go for you, go against you. It's hard. I mean, as a player and as a coach, it's hard to not get upset. But really, my feeling is they tend to even out in a match. Maybe not in a set, but usually the course of a match. They tend to, you know, the frustrating ones, though, is when they go your way at 1-0 and they go against you at 20-all, right? And that's when it becomes kind of frustrating. But, I mean, it's human error, right? Like in any sport with referees, you know, just baseball and the balls and strikes and, you know, football and penalties. I mean, you're going to miss things. It's part of the game. And the ball just moves so fast now at this level. That's the biggest thing. And McMullen out of the back row, dug up there by Graham. Frazier's just going to give a free ball opportunity here to Alberta. Walsh back to Nikifor. And Frazier one-on-one. Graham there to give a big high five. And it's now just a three-point game, 21-18.
Frazier continues to lead this Saskatchewan Huskies team, 8 points for number eight so far, and really shown some fire here when other guys are maybe a little bit tired, maybe a little bit sore after three long days of competition.
Oh, and Walsh trying to squeeze that one over to Barnes. Chambers tried to cut it off and was only able to get a piece. And it's 21-19.
Walsh was kind of laughing to himself on that one. Chambers thought it was going to him and got a piece of it.
Guys, you know why Saskatchewan's come back in this set? Good karma by Coach Brian Gavlis. He was trying to give the point to Alberta. He was telling the lines and telling the refs, no, it was in. They didn't take it. And now his team's rattled off 4 points in a row, and they've closed 21-19.
We've seen those coaches' points from Gavlis all weekend long, calling timeouts and going on a bit of a run. And, you know, just calling that ball in, just like you said, getting a bit of good karma. The volleyball gods are with them today, and they get a few points out of it.
So what was once a pretty big lead, and Alberta in full control, it's now just a two-point ball game, 21-19.
Well, I think just statistically one of the biggest difference between the first and the second sets here is Alberta in the first set, 13 kills and 3 errors, whereas in the second set, they've had 11 kills and they've made 9 attack errors. Really uncharacteristic of Alberta to attack at only 6.5% efficiency. And at the same time in this set, Saskatchewan has gone ahead and had, you know, 6 kills on their on their 18 attempts.
Walsh back door to Nikifor. Frazier again with a nice block. Goes back to Alberta. Chambers, his attack kept alive. Off the top of the block there on the over bump. Ball goes all the way back to the net. Tough play there from Saskatchewan as they're just trying to keep it alive.
That's a really tough play there because Novakowski turning and playing that ball to the net. CJ Gavlis running with him, you know, pursuing as a setter should in a situation like that. The ball ended up going right to the tape where almost a perfect pass would have been.
Yeah, you can kind of see he got it off the thumb, not off the forearm. Had he got it off the forearms, it would have been straight up and Gavlis would have been right there.
Middle to Epp, Walsh diving save. May comes in with the bump set to Nikifor, and a great job of just seeing that hand of Epp and just softly kind of rolls it off and down. Very effective shot there from Ryan Nikifor.
Yeah, Epp not sealing to the net there. His right shoulder's coming off, and that's why Nikifor was able to put it off his hand.
Jump float from Walsh, going away from the spin serve here, the late stages of the second set. Noah Kosky back row. Manages to find the seam in that Alberta defense. And now it's Nelson who will serve. Interesting, guys. Coach Gavlis has decided to sub in number 14, Alexander Javelis, instead of going to libero Etienne Huggenbach. Interesting decision.
Fifth-year player, definitely just getting some time in. Give him some chance to get some touches in the last match of his career.
Nice play there at the net by Gavlis to put it over. And then we see Frazier, who's really come alive with the block, gets Barnes on that one. 23-21, got a hand to Saskatchewan. They were down and out here after losing the first set, down in the second, and they battle all the way back to make this two-point ball game. If they can win this second set, we're gonna have a pretty exciting bronze medal game. Alberta looking a little bit out of sync there on that ball. A chance for Saskatchewan. Nelson out of the back row with a big kill. Nice find there from Gavlis. 23-22 Alberta. Jesse Nelson down the line there, kind of a backdoor shot. And Coach Davidek will call timeout. And the Huskies.
Yeah, that set there for Nelson looked low, and he kind of came through it awkwardly, but does a great job at putting it in the court. And, you know, we mentioned it before, he's turned it up since the first day, and him and Fraser are really handling the load right now for the Huskies, and Gavlis is doing a much better job at delivering that ball.
So I guess coming out of the timeout for Alberta here, what is probably your best offensive run? You know, they've tried Barnes on the right side a couple times, stacked with the setter here. You know, I think they're going to either force middle, right, or they're going to look to go to the far side of the court to a Nick four.
Now, I'm sure there's no panic right now for the Alberta Golden Bears. They still lead by one. They still hold that first set. They still, you know, I'm sure they still consider themselves the best team in the country, so they're able just to reset here. They're going to side out, hopefully take this set.
23-22, coming out of the timeout. Andrew Nelson with the serve. Taken there by May Walsh. Inside set to Nika Four. And Epp and Gavlis with the step block. And we're tied up at 23.
Yeah, Epp, only his second point of the game, but coming up with a timely block. Just presses well and puts it into the open court.
We saw in the replay there that ball was set a little bit inside. And Epp was there for a big block. Walsh back to Barnes, and Barnes cross court. Noah Koski was there, just couldn't quite handle it.
And you know what? I've seen that a few times where the six-back player from the Huskies is really charging that seam, and a few times the one defender, whether it's Nelson or Gavlis, is kind of left standing there in a better position. Kind of like them see them stay further back, take that shot off the hands, leave the cross court bang to the one defender.
Set point opportunity for the Bears, but Barnes' serve goes long. Almost right into our cameraman there. Him flying into your living room. 24-24 as Graham checks back into the front row.
Interesting in that last serve receive, something that could have been considered, of course, is the four-man serve receive, but would have been bringing Nelson in, but you did have your libero off the court, right, with Arbelavis on the court, right? So the libero could have come back out there and helped in that four-man serve receive.
Good call, Dan. Pass gets pulled off the net there for Walsh. McMullen, soft block by Gavlis. Play continues, Nikifor with a roll shot. Nelson with the save, up to Noah Koski, and Noah Koski through the hands of Chambers and down, and we now have a set point for the Huskies, 25-24.
This Saskatchewan team is just scrappy, and you know, I think we go back to what we said on the first day, which is definitely not an insult, it's definitely from that lifestyle that you have on the Prairies. They're hard workers, and you see that from their team here today.
I agree with you 100%. That's kind of the reputation, I think, that we have, you know, in the Prairies, though, right? I know people who don't live in Manitoba, Saskatchewan, you know, they just can't believe the winters you go through, and I think it's a good thing. It's a great quality to have growing up. 25-25.
Definitely could use that quality in some of my club players in Toronto, that's for sure.
Gavlis finds Epp, but it goes back onto their side after Gorenson got enough. And we now have another set point back to Alberta.
I guess we have to admit that Everett and I both moved away from those harsh winters.
You guys are smart.
It wasn't my choice. My parents made that choice, but...
Dan's suntanning in Calgary when I'm shoveling the driveway. Outside to Noah Koski, and the step block there from Gorenson. And it wasn't easy, but Alberta battles to take the set 27-25 as we see the big time stuff block from John Gorenson. And now Alberta one set away from winning the CIS bronze medal in what is the 50th anniversary of the CIS Men's Volleyball Championships. And Dan, you've known Brett Walsh for a long time, had an opportunity to see him play at many levels. If you see some of his highlights here, you know, what makes Brett Walsh so special?
You know, Walsh has such a great understanding of the control of his hands and understanding of positioning along the net. He does a really good job of moving to the ball quickly, getting set in terms of his lateral movement usually, so that he's not drifting forward or back. And with that, he now has a very good understanding of how to get the ball to his hitter in the right zone that the hitter's going to want it. That takes a lot of time and experience to understand how to release a ball so that it's in the best place for your hitter based on your movement and based on their transition or movement from the pass or defense. And he has a great understanding of that. With that great hand control, he can do some creative things along the net. He saves the ball. You know, he's able to go up, bring balls back before they break the plane, and not only just bring them back, but bring them back to multiple hitters, right? A lot of setters can go up and save a ball from going over, but they can't control it to many different attack zones. He can control it to all those different zones.
And Everett, we have on the other side of the net, we have CJ Gavlis. And what do you like about this first-year center, the CIS Rookie of the Year?
You know, we saw a little bit of hesitation from him in his first match. Of course, his first CIS tournament match. But since then, he's done a really good job, always giving his hitters a chance to, you know, get a good swing of the ball. But most importantly, he's a hustler. He's going to go out there and work hard 150% of the time. He's going to get to balls that you don't think he's going to. He's going to be scrappy on defense, and he's going to fight to the end, you know. Growing up in a volleyball house with Coach Gavlis as your father, I'm sure you pick up a few things along the way, and the poise and the maturity and the composure that he's been showing so far as a first-year setter at the CIS tournament is very impressive.
I think just to add on to that, we talked about the pedigree and growing up. Of course, Rod Welsh was a great setter for our country, and Brett has capitalized on those learnings over the years. I know just being in Calgary, I've heard some stories from people who have been around the Volley Dome, you know, telling me stories about how, Rod would be in there with Brett doing all sorts of creative drills, things that Brett was probably not capable of doing at a younger age, and wondering, would it pay off? And of course, now with that control that he's demonstrating with all those creative sets, it probably has paid off.
You know, it's interesting you bring up Rod, because I had a chance to talk to him when I was in Edmonton earlier this year for the Olympic qualifiers. And, you know, he talks to me about how Brett became this player. You know, as much as I'm sure there's a ton of credit that goes to the Canuck Volleyball Club and the time he spent playing club volleyball, but, you know, his father thinks that Brett really got good in those extracurricular activities when they were in the Volley Dome, just the two of them, and setting and hitting and just straight up playing volleyball. You know, younger players have to realize that the best player at any sport, you take any sport, you know, you look at the Jordans, the Gretzkys, the Crosbys, those guys are good at their sport because they played their sport outside of that allotted time, and they worked on their craft and they honed their craft, and that's exactly why Brett Walsh is good. Rod Walsh tells me stories of him and Taylor Arnett and Brett Walsh just going in there and hitting middle balls for hours and hours and hours. So we've obviously seen that connection here this weekend and throughout the season, and that's what little younger players should be doing, just getting in the gym and just playing volleyball.
Well, that's a movement I think that our country, you know, that we want to try to take, is that not waiting until grade 7 or 8 mm-hmm. to getting early exposure to volleyball, right? We have to look at, in our country, at 3 and 4 and 5 years old, we're already playing organized soccer and hockey and even basketball at some stages. You know, for volleyball, it's the motor part of it, you know, the coordination part of it, it's very tough, but it's taking an initiative and just catching the ball, you know, throwing the ball over the net, mm-hmm. sometimes letting it bounce, sort of different rules to it, getting the players familiar with the sport. Because I know, Dad, that's one thing that always kind of stood up to me. We went to Cuba a few years back with our team, and we talked to the coaches there, and we said, you know, when do your players start playing volleyball? And they said, I don't know, 4 or 5 years old. And we were mind blown by that. And then I remember I said, well, they do it for our country in hockey. It makes sense if volleyball's one of the main sports in Cuba, then they would do it there. And, you know, it's just something that I think we've done a better job of. We have to try to find programs for our youngsters, as I think it would be very beneficial down the road. And we see play continue here. It's F. And Dan, how are things looking on the stats there for after two sets?
Well, from Alberta, they've done a very good job of getting Gorenson involved on the attack. 4 kills on his 7 attempts with just one error. The outside efficiency is a big difference when you compare the two teams. Nikifor, Barnes, and McMullen combining for, I think, 20 kills, whereas on the other side of the court, you have Nelson, Fraser, and Nowakowski combining for 16 kills. So a little bit of difference there, and that last set just came down to 2 points.
Fraser, left side, dug up there by Barnes. Nikifor out of the back row, off the block of Epp, and into the crowd. 2-1, Alberta.
It'll be Well, I'm looking to see how Saskatchewan can bounce back. We saw them make that late push and even hold a set point to even up at 1-1. And it seems like all weekend they've been playing catch-up in all their matches. It worked out on the first day, not so much yesterday against McMaster. Let's see if they can come back in this one.
Good job by Albertus to keep that one alive. Nelson, the late block there from McMullen. And he makes some pay. Side out Huskies, 2-2.
Just one other interesting point here for Saskatchewan. I believe just one kill out of the middle of the court. One kill for Graham. No kills yet for Epp.
Yeah, for guys who really can be very effective, they just haven't been able to get them going, as McMullen's going to go way up high to get that one. And that's such a tough shot. That ball's coming from behind you like that, way up in the air. And we talk about the ball very easily to get lost in this roof and these lights. Not much McMullen could do on that one.
No, I almost thought that set from Nikifor was going to touch the basketball net above the court. Just misses it. Fortunately, McMullen chips it into the block.
Zingorenson tried to let that one come to a better spot for him there, then almost put him in it. He didn't really have a shot. He tried to chip it over. It goes out of bounds. It was almost like Gorenson maybe thought it wasn't for him in a way. There was that slight hesitation there. The ball was going to maybe quickly go over him to McMullen, and then he realized he had to try to put it over, and he puts it out of bounds. Walsh, nice pipe find there to Barnes. And just you see on the replay here, the creativity to find him behind you on a great run there, and a nice shot by Ryley Barnes to cap it off. Now serving for Alberta is the Australian, Alex McMullen. That pass there, be a free ball coming now to Alberta. May, nice pass. Walsh kind of gave her the old, call that? The taparoo? I'm not quite sure what that one was.
It looked like he wanted to go with a one-handed bounce or maybe a two-handed throwdown. I'm not sure.
It was interesting. And then he put his hands, like he turned like he was going to hit, brought his elbow back, brought his hand back like he was going to hit, and then just pushed it with his palms.
So, yeah. Just like Chubbs told Happy Gilmore, just tap it in, right?
Tap it in.
Did you see a replay of that ace? Just finds the sideline. 5-4 Alberta. McMullen continues to serve. Passing to Rokoski off the net. Gavlis outside, back to him. And he uses that block of Walsh there to his advantage. Side out Huskies.
Novakovsky slowly getting back into this game, slowly putting some points on the board. And you know, other nights we've seen him stand up and really push it on his own, but tonight he's getting some help from Nelson. He's getting some help from Frazier as well, as they spread out the offense a little.
That pass to McMullen goes into the net, and Walsh can't come up with it. What do you call that? You call that an ace? You give that an ace to you guys there? I mean,
I would give that an ace. Yeah, you know, he went right at May. May unfortunately couldn't handle it. Definitely call that an ace, as Brett Walsh did everything he could to handle it and couldn't get it up.
Hey, if you're keeping track of stats, you can find a way to give your guys a little bit, right? That's never a bad thing. You know, we had one yesterday there. We had kind of a similar type debate, right? We had a two hits violation on the second contact, maybe, or.
The stat part is always interesting. I've always said, like, if a hitter goes up and hits a ball and the defender catches it, right? It's a carry ball. It's not a kill.
Yeah.
It's a ball handling error.
Yeah, you're right, Jess. You're right.
That's an interesting one for sure.
You know, you'd hate to be that guy, that hitter that goes up. You know, they're looking for that career number 1,000 or something. You know, hits it. And libero just catches it just to give you that look, right?
Like you're saying, when Brett Favre lied down so Michael Strahan could break the sack record in the single season sack record in the NFL. Gavlis is slow serve, taken there by Barnes. Walsh up high to Chambers. Nice dig there by Hagenbach. Gavlis bumps it outside to Nowakowski. No block. Pick up there by May on the run. Walsh quickly outside to Barnes. Barnes through the seam of the block. And Frazier not happy with himself as that one went right off the arm.
You know, those stats could always be used, because generally the people taking stats aren't the volleyball people. I know one guy who once played for me at George Brown used to tap his head whenever he wanted, whenever it was his block. But the thing is, he would tap his head when he was nowhere even near the block and get credited for it.
Nice block there from Chambers and Nikifor.
Speaking of the block, I think Nikifor would be the one to maybe tap there.
Yep. We used to have a rule, one of the teams Dan and I coach, you got the guys are doing stats on the sidelines, and the guy who got the block had to kind of acknowledge it, and if he didn't acknowledge, then no one got it.
Yeah, right? we'd always end like, how did you end up with seven blocks? I don't remember you getting one.
Speaking of blocks, Alberta's really closing it up nicely as you see the third man coming across, and it was Barnes that reached over to get that one.
And as we see that replay, that's just an intimidating trio to go up with Nikifor, Barnes, and Chambers there.
Graham in the middle. McMullen got a piece, but Chambers and Nikifor late turning around after the block, and it goes under the net back to Saskatchewan side. Side out for the Huskies, as Nowakowski will now serve. His team trails by one. Early on here in this third set, it's Alberta who leads two sets to none in this bronze medal match. Chambers, middle. I've got to go over. Good communication there by the Golden Bears to keep that one alive. Pipe to Nowakowski, and McMullen can't get the dig.
McMullen's obviously a little disappointed with that effort. He's been great on defense all day, and that one kind of sneaks through as we see it again here and lands just in front of him, and he punted that ball off the ball girl real quick.
Nowakowski again with the serve. Mays pass off the net. Walsh to Nikifor on the left. And a great dig there by Saskatchewan, but they can't come up with a second contact. Side out Alberta.
We now see Ryley Barnes heading back to serve for the Golden Bears.
And Barnes playing his last match of CIS. Had a great career here with Alberta. From St. Paul, Alberta. And I think I asked you yesterday, Dan, but we never got to it. Where exactly is St. Paul in Alberta? We're not quite sure either. Stan's lived in Calgary for a couple years. He hasn't come across St. Paul yet. As Barnes with a great diving save. Free ball coming here to the Huskies. Pipe Nowakowski, May, great dig. A good rally going on here right now in this third set. Graham on the back set. Barnes with the dig. Nikifor is going to go up and hit it. Roll shot. Takes the setter. Gavis out of the play. Hagenbach high outside to Nelson. And Nelson off the hands and down. Point for the Huskies.
That's a nice attack by Nelson. Really rotating his right hip and hitting hard cross and high. Jared, I don't know where St. Paul is, but I know that their club team is the St. Paul Rage.
St. Paul Rage? Okay. Good to know.
Let's do a quick Google map search here.
Yeah, I see exactly where it is. Everdol. We'll figure that out for us here. Walsh goes back to Nikifor, off the block of Epp, and into the ball boy. Side out Alberta.
Well, they do have one thing in St. Paul, and that's a Tim Hortons.
Okay, I would guess, I wonder how many towns in Canada don't have a Tim Hortons, right? That would be interesting. And if they don't, as we see Chambers go to McMullen. In Manitoba, at least, every town, and Dan can probably verify this, every town in Manitoba has a chicken chef or a chicken delight. No matter how big or small.
I've never been to either of those out here, but I'll be sure to check them out next time I go to Winnipeg.
You know what we did have a chance to check out this trip is Mr. Sub. Dan and I have ate lunch there 3 days in a row at
the
hotel. And I got to say, Mr. Sub is moving back up my list of places to eat lunch. I'm not really a Subway guy, and so I don't eat subs very often, but Mr. Sub, fantastic lunch the last 3 days.
Yeah, so St. Paul is actually northwest of Edmonton, closer to the Saskatchewan border, northeast of Edmonton, northwest of Lloydminster.
Okay, good to know. Thank you, Everett, for that geography lesson here, as we were wondering where Ryley Barnes' hometown was. Hagenbach outside to Fraser. May with the dig. Barnes chases it down. Free ball coming here to the Huskies. Gavlis. Oh, and the pump play to Epp. We saw that against UNB. Worked really well, and it works again here. Oh, and we see Nikifor awkwardly goes into the stands.
That was a scary play if you're a fan of the Bears and just a fan of Ryan Nikifor in general, as he's slow to get up and he's hurting a little bit.
And I think right away that adrenaline and makes that not
hurt
as much.
We have a chance to see on the replay there, guys.
Kind of went right
into the wooden part, the base part of the stands.
Yeah, the bridge here is very intimate, as you can see the stands coming right up to the edge of the court. Not much room for the players to go flying into the stands with.
Looks like he's okay, though. We hope Alberta already had one injury to their starting lineup, as Taylor Arnett injured yesterday in that semifinal. Kind of a ankle, foot, somewhere in that region. Not quite sure exactly what the injury was, but not dressed today in his fourth year. Sounds like he will make a recovery and be okay for next season. As Dallas, the dump attempt, blocked there by Alberta, 14-12.
Even though Alberta's up 14-12, Saskatchewan has been playing really well in this set.
Absolutely.
They're attacking extremely efficiently, 8 kills, 2 errors, compared to Alberta's attack, which has been 7 kills in 3 errors.
Inside set to Nowakowski, he tips it over into the soft spot of the defense, but Alberta was on the net anyways.
Make that 9 kills. The other thing to add is that we talked about Saskatchewan in the first two sets only having one middle attack. They've added 3 more middle kills in this set alone.
No, really spreading out the offense so far. You've got Nowakowski with 9, Frazier with 8, and a few guys with 7 and 5 as well. Just going everywhere, and it's paying dividends.
Walsh trying to fake out. Oh. He's going to go to the middle. Quickly goes outside, and Gavlis got stuck on the block, and the tip will score.
And 15-13. Even though the set wasn't great, he did, as you said, he deked out Gavlis, and that gave a no-block situation, so all that had to happen on the
Definitely think Gavlis slipped a little there as he pushed outside to get that block up. He was closer to the ground as we see Graham. Wow. Haven't seen him bounce a ball like that yet this tournament as he puts that one down with authority.
Yeah, great job there by Robert Graham. And Graham, he's not, he's only, says 6'6", and I think kind of all three of these guys, Nelson, Nowakowski, and Graham, are kind of a deceptive 6'6 out there. And but he has good leaping ability and very smart on the court. Can't hit that. Hagenbach was yelling at him there, but the referee's called 4 hits. But either way, it was going to be a violation.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the 4 hits there, but.
No, it's not a 4-hit call, but definitely a libero set violation.
And I think even Andrew Robb and Azad just had a bit of a moment as they kind of smiled, laughed to each other. They knew the right team got the point, but maybe the proper call wasn't made.
Trying to get Azad's attention here.
Just like we saw yesterday as Gavlis and Preston were talking to the down ref. I don't think they're going to give us any more face time than they would them.
Once again, I want to give a special thanks to our webcast partner, McMaster University Center for Continuing Education, for helping to make this event possible. We very much appreciate your contributions this weekend. So the referees still kind of chatting to each other a little bit. And at the end of the day, the right team got the point there. Mm-hmm. And it was, Hagenbach was just screaming at Nelson not to hit it. And, this is something Dan and I have talked about many times, Deborah, is that why are players still confused by that rule? I mean, it's very simple. Libero can't set a ball. He can't set an attacker in front of the attack line, front row or back row. It doesn't matter. And yet players are continually, and coaches for that matter, are continually surprised when that gets called.
I think it's just that, especially on the player side of things, coaches not so much, but when you're out there and you're playing and you're focused on hitting that ball, if you see that ball go up in front of you, you're not necessarily thinking that, hey, I'm not allowed to hit it. Right? And, at that point, instinct takes over. I want to jump up and put it down. But definitely, I think that's where volleyball is such a cerebral game. And you have to be able to make quick decisions so quickly based off all the information you have. And maybe he just saw the set and went at it and wasn't really listening to his team. As
there you
finally
go.
I get my touch.
I was reaching for it, Everett, but I thought, no, I want you to get your chance there as you grab that ball that came into our announcer station here. And I think what would help, guys, is if the libero wore a different colored jersey, it'd be easier to tell when they set you the ball. Interestingly enough, as that serve McCluskey goes in the net, I remember some stories when the libero first was started, they had to sit in a chair on the bench with an L taped on it, and there was all these really weird things. It was in the very, very, very beginning of the rule. And now, obviously, it's such a huge part of our game. And Barnes' serve taken there by Hagenbach.
We've talked a lot about the role of the libero this weekend, and looking at all these teams, every one of these teams has a solid libero that's kind of that back row quarterback, and you're starting to really see if that libero position is so crucial to stabilize your serve receive, keep you going on defense, and five plays out of six, you've got him back there ready to play defense and really giving you the best shot to give that ball up, and we're kind of starting to see that teams need a good libero if they want to be successful at the higher level.
Yeah, and I think it's a position where you can win without having the best one, but you can't win if you don't have a good one. And you see a service ace there from Barnes down the line, and now looks like Coach Gavlis We'll call timeout. We're going to see this serve here. Just clipped the sideline. I feel like we've seen that replay a couple times from Barnes tonight on that serve, and he's trying to go out, finish his career in style. 19-15, Alberta leads.
Yeah, you're seeing, you know, a lot less determination right now from Saskatchewan. They're still playing well. They're still bringing energy and scrapping away, but you can kind of see that train of Alberta as they continue to gain momentum.
I think we have a chance here, guys, to see a slow motion replay of that serve and how close he was to painting that line. You see Barnes go up here, coming way into the court and just finds that sideline. Great serve there from Ryley Barnes. Good job by the guys on the truck getting that one.
Yeah, big shout out to the crew from Mohawk College putting together a great broadcast for us. Just super seamless for us to be here and talk while they put up some great moving images for you guys to watch at home. Another sub for the Huskies as we see Alexander Arvalius come back in the fifth year.
So obviously, trying to maybe solidify the pass here a little bit with Barnes serving as he's coming for the middle. He's kind of essentially dropped back right in. And now I'm sure Arvalius will serve. And I wouldn't be surprised if he maybe even stays in for the back row as he did in the second set.
They did use him at the end of the second set, and it paid off. They were able to stay with Alberta to the end.
And he's a fifth-year player as well. And we talked about the fifth years, not a starter, but still in his last game of volleyball here and at the collegiate level. That serve goes long. Actually, Graham will check back in, and then Hagenbach will take him out. <laughs> 20-16. Chambers with the serve. Jump float, taken there by Hagenbach, off the net. Noah Koski, that one's got some spin on it, but we've seen that be let go all tournament long. Nikifor, good job getting around there. He was kind of stuck in the middle of the court. Good footwork, got outside, and put that ball down. It's now 21-16, Alberta.
Great opportunity here for Chambers to get into this pressure match. Of course, the circumstances aren't great with the injury to Arnett, but, you know, Chambers is going to be stepping in next year with the absence of John Goranson, and now he's got a chance to go out there and win a medal for his team.
Middle to Epp, kind of miss hit, but it does find the floor. Walsh not very happy that he couldn't come up with that one. 21-17. So the Huskies going to need to string together a few points here if they want to extend this match. You know, if this does end three straight ties, we're going to have a bit of a break here before that that final as it's scheduled for 6 o'clock. And that ball over the net, call on Walsh. I think it'll just give the fans a chance to really fuel up before that game if there is a big break here.
Well, the fans and us.
That's true. Absolutely.
Get some coffee in us, get maybe some...
Never had a cup of coffee in my life ever.
Never?
Never. No, not once.
Wow, I'm impressed.
Yeah, it's... For a coach, you know, people always find that hard to believe, but...
The parents on my teams know that if you're driving me to the tournament, I need some sort of sustenance in the morning. It's usually the shape of this red cup.
We're going to have a timeout here from Coach Daviduk. 21-19, and we saw this last set as well. Kind of a big lead for Alberta. You know, getting to the end of the set. Almost, you know, start maybe feel a little comfortable, and then Saskatchewan pounces in on you there, and they make it a two-point ball game. Be curious to see if they can take that next step and come back and actually win this third and not just make it close in the scoreboard.
Jared, I'd like to add the you know, insight into this match, but since Everett's holding that Tim Hortons cup and he hasn't rolled up the rim yet, I am totally distracted.
Roll up the rim.
Okay,
roll,
okay. Are we doing this alive? Yeah. Can we get the camera down on it?
And we've got...
We had a play again. Actually, I had one on Thursday, and I don't usually drink Tim Hortons because there's none around me where I live in Toronto, but I had one on Thursday, and I actually won. Nice. I won a free coffee, which I got yesterday.
There you go. Congrats. Was that the free one?
No, I got that one yesterday for yesterday's match.
Okay, fair enough. Nelson serve into the net, and that hurts with your team down now 22-19. Nick Ford goes back to serve. There's an interesting energy in the gym right now, right? Because you know that a lot of people are here for that next game, but they're still into this one. It's been some good action as Nika Forrest's serve goes into the net. And that's traditionally kind of the way that it is. There's always a bit of a break between the bronze and the gold, but people start to file in. They want to get a good seat. They take interest in the match, and it usually can become pretty exciting. And Saskatchewan can put together a couple points here. I'd love to see a great finish this match. Oh, that ball from May was taken pretty low. But Epp and Noah Koski with the big-time stuff block on Ryan Nikifor.
Yeah, for sure. And I think you're seeing a lot of Mass Marauders fans. You're seeing a lot of Maroon in the crowd. But at the end of the day, they are volleyball fans. And we don't get to see teams like the Golden Bears or the Huskies all that often. So it just gives us a chance to see what's going on the other side of the country and maybe see how our teams out here in Ontario can stack up.
Well, I think we might be getting our wish here. Saskatchewan has put together three big points in a row, and it's now tied 22-all. The serve of Fraser giving May some trouble. Just when it looked like Alberta was about to win this match three straight, the Huskies just claw back right into it. And now Walsh slips. A great job just to keep it alive. McMullen, and then they say there was a touch on the block. Coach Gavlis does not like that. And then Fraser misses the dig. That one was tough.
Definitely have an argument there for Coach Gavlis. Looked like there was no touch on the block. Kind of bounced around a little off the tape, but at the end of the day, point goes to the Bears, and let's see if Saskatchewan can fight back.
23-22. We're in for an exciting finish here. McMullen serve. Hagenbach got a piece. Fraser, a valiant attempt, but isn't able to get it over. Four hits violation on the Huskies.
Bronze medal point now for Alberta.
And Coach Gavlis has one time left, and he will call it. Still unhappy about that non-touch call. And I mean, it's so hard to say, guys. I mean, we've seen those balls. You see it at practice when there's no blockers, the ball come back like that. When there is blockers, it can come back. And, you know, it's almost impossible to know for sure one way or the other. But the thing is, in those situations, it's a judgment call. So if you saw it, you saw it. And you can't, you know, there's no argument. It's not necessarily a rule where you missed a rule. It's just a call. And the referees saw it, and play continued. And they had a chance to dig it up, and Fraser missed the dig.
Right, and it's a 50-50 play, and what you have to do is you really have to focus on the next ball, you know, and I'm not sure that, whether a timeout would have helped at 23-22 mark after having a controversial play, but of course, next serve came in, and it was nice.
Absolutely, and you know, you said there Fraser was on the baseline, looked at that ball was going out, made the decision last minute, so yeah, sure, you didn't get the call going your way, but you got to play that very next ball.
So we'll see if Saskatchewan can extend this thing here. We have a match point opportunity for Alberta Golden Bears. They look to win this match, three straight, and take the CIS bronze medal. Noah Koski to Gavlis. Gavlis back to Noah Koski. Dug up there by Reed May. McMullen bumps it out high to Barnes, and Barnes is going to set it over the net. Noah Koski there with the pass. They go middle to Epp, and Epp goes off the block of Goranson and down. Side out U of S, and it will be Epp who goes back to serve. And what an interesting server to have here with the match on the line as we have match point opportunity number two. He can get you an ace right off the hop here if he puts
it
in.
Not to mention who's in the front row for the Bears. You've got Goranson and Barnes at 250ers. Who's Walsh going to give it to?
Great mention there, but the serve goes into the net. And with that, Alberta takes it 25-23. And they are your 2016 CIS bronze medalists in men's volleyball. I'm sure not the color they came to Hamilton for, but still, really a great season for Alberta all around.
Absolutely, and a bit disappointing on the way that match ended. Would have loved to see Barnes or Goranson get a big swing to, you know, close out the careers at the same time. Congratulations to the Alberta Golden Bears bronze medalists this year. You mentioned before, not the color they came here, not the color they wanted, but I'm sure they'll still accept it and look back and, you know, with fond memories on the season as they did play well. And, you know, especially for those two seniors, John Goranson and Ryley Barnes, I personally don't think that their volleyball career is done. I think this journey still has at least a few more years to go, whether it's pro or with the national team, but caps off to them for a fantastic career. Three big CIS medals in that span. There's a lot to be said for that.
And guys, we have an opportunity to see some highlights here from the match. And what was an interesting game for sure. Alberta came out and really came out flying out of the gates early on. Saskatchewan, though, battled in those second and third sets. And, you know, big, got to really make mention, obviously, at this time of year when in these situations is to the fifth-year players. And one of those fifth-year players who's been named the player of the game here for Alberta, number 12, Ryley Barnes. So goes out having a strong match to finish his CIS career for Saskatchewan. It was Fraser. And that kind of Barnes there sort of kind of having a laugh there, puts the player of the game award above his head, and now we're actually going to have the presentation of the bronze medals right here, right now. And you know, interesting, every year the process of this changes. You know, some years, you know, they get all the teams back here and do all the medals at once. You know, this year they're doing the bronze medals right after this match, and you know, I think I always kind of like getting the medals right after the game. Mm-hmm. You know, as a team, you don't want to have to stick around for the next match. Well, so you see all the Alberta players coming forward here, and John Goranson, one of the fifth-year players, goes out in style. And Dan, as these players come up, what did we see there on those final stats?
Yeah, well, I think that the one thing that was nice to see is Saskatchewan's resilience and their ability to stay in the match, both in the second and third sets. But specifically this third set, they actually outperformed Alberta on offense by attacking at 29% compared to Alberta's percentage, which I think was, I'll pull it up, just 17% on offense. But the difference, of course, is Alberta had, I think, 12 more digs than Saskatchewan in this set alone. Alberta with a couple more blocks in this set and three more service aces in this third set. So showing that it's not just always what can you do on offense. It's a matter of how many offensive opportunities can you create, how tough can you serve, and how well can you defend, and extend rallies, which I think Alberta did well in this third set to allow them to come away with a victory. On the Saskatchewan side of the court, like I said, much more efficient attacking, 29% in this third set. But we noticed after the first two sets, not a lot of middle involvement, only one kill out of Graham, and not any production out of Epp. In this third set, they added, I believe, another 7 kills out of the middle alone, just in this third set. So a good job by Saskatchewan making some adjustments to keep them in this set, give them a chance at the end. But at the end of the day, Alberta just a little bit tougher in all parts of the game, allowing them to come through.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And, you know, big ups to the Saskatchewan squad, who, as we mentioned before, they had to upset first Winnipeg and then Manitoba to get here. And, you know, being in this match and being here is really a testament to the work that Coach Gavlis has done with this group the next few years. And considering that some of your best players, like, yeah, you're graduating a few guys, but some of your best players are young and are willing to put it on the line again for you next year, they're in a great spot moving on to the 2016-17 season.
So Alberta with the huge roster here, we've been going through the medalists this whole time here. I think we've finally got all of an hour into the coaching staff here. Brock Dowdick, who is kind of an associate head coach role this year. You know, Terry Danilmuck is still the head coach, and Brock taking some different responsibilities and, you know, doing his master's at U of A and kind of part of the process of how things work there for their thing. They have to work with one of the varsity teams, and wouldn't be surprised if he was a head coach of a program somewhere sometime soon. Not sure if he'll be at the CIS level or if he'll go to look to go CCAA, but we'll see how things go for him in the future. A great player in his own right and now a great coach.
And another great player, as we see here, head coach Terry Danilmuck. Now Danilmuck, really one of the legends of Canadian coaching. If you have the opportunity to even get a chance to talk to him or play for one of his teams or go to a camp that with him, and you see the way he runs his teams and the way he gets his guys to be so close and have such camaraderie, if you ever get a chance to talk to him or be in the gym with him, I definitely suggest to do so.
You know, one interesting thing is years ago when I was here with Manitoba, Alberta was the number one seed. They were the best team all season long, and you know, they played Trinity Western in the final, and Trinity Western was just unbelievable. They beat them 3 straight sets, and Alberta really didn't even have a chance in that match. And I remember they were showing one of the timeouts on TV, and he called the guys together in the second set. They lost the first set pretty badly, and second set losing again. And he said, you know, guys, I can handle if we're not the best team today, right? But let's just at least go out there and play our best, right? And that was the thing was, you know, kind of something that's always sort of resonated with me is, you know, if the other guys are better than us today, then so be it. We can't control how well they play, you know. You know, he's really been in the finals so many times, so much experience, and, you know, back-to-back gold medalists. This year, no, they go away with bronze. And still very much to look forward to for this Alberta team. They return a very large part of this roster next season, and with them hosting the Nationals, they will be a very difficult team to beat. So, guys, any final thoughts here? We're about an hour and a half away, so we're going to step aside for a while, but any final thoughts on this bronze medal game before we come back for the gold?
Well, I think it was a great performance by Saskatchewan, showing some resilience as we talked about, making some adjustments as they went through the first set into the second and third to compete with Alberta and make sure that Alberta earned the match. Alberta coming in, obviously, one of the favorites to be in the final. They're going to be not satisfied walking away with a bronze medal, but it sure feels a lot better than leaving without a medal. And Alberta did what they needed to today to make sure that they're walking away with that feeling. Really excited for the next match.
Any final thoughts, Everett?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think today what we saw is an Alberta Bears team that's really just one of the top best teams in the country. And Saskatchewan, they gave it their all. They're a fantastic team. They work hard. And, you know, I've really come to love the Saskatchewan team over the course of this weekend. They work really hard. They don't give up. They never go away. And, you know, for a scrappy team and the way they work, they definitely don't have the talent or the skill that the Golden Bears have. And you can make the argument that maybe no one does in the country. But they stuck with them point by point, and no matter how frustrating and how long this weekend was for them, they played great, and they really represented not only their school but the province of Saskatchewan really well.
So I think, guys, that'll do it for us here for this match. Like I said, we're going to step aside for about 90 minutes as that game will start at 6 o'clock. Everybody has a chance to refuel, do a couple things here, kill some time, and be back with us at 6 o'clock Eastern in what promises to be a fantastic match with the number one seed McMaster Marauders and number two seed Trinity Western Spartans. We will see you in 90 minutes. Take care.